All right, welcome everybody. Sorry we're starting a little bit late, although that was the plan all along, so gotcha. Welcome, this is, I don't want to say too much. I'm Jonathan Bartlett, and along with Jensen, who, if you don't want to stand up here, actually, because I think she deserves a lot of credit, we started putting this together in October last year. We had part one of Stories Matter, which is the overall name for this talk. And it was great success. There was a lot of demand for a follow-up, so that's what we're doing here today. We don't want to say a whole lot because, unlike last time, I'm not moderating. Richie Pope is moderating. He's going to do a phenomenal job. But I do just want to say, really, thank you very much for all being here. It's wonderful to see the number of people in the room today on a Saturday. I want to say thank you to everyone online that's listening or will be listening later on to the recorded talk. It's encouraging to see the number of views go up and up and up on the first one. So we, at the Society, we're committed to making a difference and making change and being relevant, not just for the future or the past, but for the future. And I think these talks say a lot about that. So just a few thank yous to the Society, to everybody that works here, but then also especially to President Tim O'Brien. Maybe a lot of y'all don't know him who are up here or listening or in the room, but he actually does a lot and is integral to making sure, giving the freedom and the platform to me to start helping to do all this here. So I think it's worth noting that thanking Tim is a big deal. So anyway, from here, Jensen's gonna speak.
Thanks so much everybody for coming. We want y'all to engage in the conversation. So raise your hand, tweet at the Society page, and we'll try and bring as much up as possible. Thanks again.
All right, Richie Pope.
Thanks for coming out. So if you didn't know, Stories Matters too. So we had the first part. I was on the panel. Maybe a few people in here were on the panel, the first part. And we talked about, obviously we just jump right into diversity, inclusion, and illustration. And we touched on a lot of things. We kind of teased like a lot of things. And like at the last minute, and there was like question at the end. We're going to pretty much just go from there and just get more real. more realer, if you will. If everyone wants to go down the line, introduce yourselves, what you do, how you want to be identified, if it's relevant.
All right, I'm testing. I'm Ronald Wimberly. I'm a cartoonist. I guess everybody here is a cartoonist. I wrote and drew Prince of Cats. I did a little, I do a little something here and there for Marvel and DC, or did some for the New Yorker. I draw comics. Yeah, and I'm drawing a comic called Gratin right now, and soon some stuff from Image that I haven't started on yet.
Thank you, Ron. My name's Yao Xiao. I am a cartoonist and illustrator. I also work as a creative director. I'm very proud of what I do. I really love it. I have done illustration for the Wall Street Journal, Time Magazine, National Geographic, and a bunch of other people. And I'm hoping to share some insights about how I get to do what I do and for people who are in school who have questions related to that. Thank you.
Hello, my name is, can you hear me? Hello, my name is Odera. I am an illustrator. I love fantasy, mythology, painting, dancing, lots of things just mixed up together. Most recently, I started a Patreon that celebrates African and Black resilience and power and reclamations, mostly inspired by just that intersection of things, identity, Sailor Moon, Beyonce. All that.
Yeah, give it up for Sailor Moon and Beyonce.
My name is John Lee. I also love Sailor Moon and Beyonce. We have this in common. I'm an illustrator. I've been working about 6 years freelancing. I'm currently in the SVA MFA illustration program. I'm interested in arts education. I'm interested in talking about the Asian American experience and Asian diaspora experience as well. So a lot of my work centers on that too. So.
My name's Shannon Wright. I'm a cartoonist and an illustrator. Big news, I just got into the student show, so I'm happy with that. I'm currently a student, and I will be graduating in May, so I'm happy about that. Pretty much, I like examining racial issues, society, things that are going on in society, gender-based issues, just issues that a lot of people aren't talking about that we need to talk about. But yeah, back to Sailor Moon and Beyonce. Love that stuff. But yeah.
Hi, I'm Alexandra Zsigmond. I'm an art director at the New York Times for the opinion section, and I've been working there for 5 years. I guess my interest there is to really bring a real diversity of voices into the newspaper and to commission people who have never done an editorial illustration before, as well as also bring in, you know, really both established and emerging illustrators to just keep sort of this very wide interest in what we show.
I'm Cathy G Johnson. I'm a cartoonist. I'm also a teacher for middle schoolers and high schoolers. And I'm currently working on a graphic novel for First Second. It's going to come out in 2017. I'm a genderqueer artist, so I work with a lot of queer topics. Yeah. Cool.
Same. All right, cool. Let's jump into Sailor Moon and Beyonce. Apparently,
So I was kind of thinking like where to start. I didn't really want to like all right, first topic, first this. But there is something that's relevant. I thought is, you know, it's kind of like an elephant in the room or something that we kind of like talk about it and then just like walk away from it. Someone's gonna say those two words: political correctness. So. There was a video that came out with John Cleese, the comedian from Monty Python, and he talked about it. Kind of opened up with like the thumbnails, like 1984, like George Orwell, Orwellian kind of things, and they kind of talk about, you know, comedians, and even though it's about comedy, it made me think about content and like, you know, there's things that, yeah, we shouldn't, that are bad, that we shouldn't say, but like, you know, are they off limits? And so I guess you know, and it's very much a topic in illustration and comics and storytelling, you know. So I guess the idea is like, is there a way to be conscious but also free in terms of like what we can use like with imagery, and can we flip them around at the same time?
I'll take it. So this is John. So we'll be saying our names a lot because we have to identify on the,
yeah,
on the online.
Every single time.
Every single time.
John again for the 34th time.
Me again, yeah. I think for a few things we have to put it right on the table, just straight up. We have to realize that everything that we do has a social context, period. So everything that you put out there, it's kind of out there. It lives on its own. It's got its own life. People are going to come at it from where they're at. And you just have to acknowledge that that's the reality of the business that we're in. Like, we create things, and these things matter, right? These things have power. So you can't have it both ways, where it's like, oh, I make something, but it's just a drawing. It's just a drawing. Don't get offended by it, you know? You can either have that, but then you can't also have like, oh, I have a piece up in the Society of Illustrators, and illustration is art, and it's a very powerful art, and it's a celebrated art with a lot of history. You can't have those two things. You have to acknowledge that it is powerful, A, and then B, you have to realize that it has social context. Like, everything you do has social context. So that's kind of like a starter point where we have to like establish a baseline, I feel.
Yeah, yeah.
Can I say something? Like, I don't know exactly what John Cleese said, but something that I think needs to be said about people who are, you know, wary of political correctness, and that's like, no one's really worried. No one's stopping you from saying things. Like, I think, you know, we should all be free to say whatever we want to say, but like, you've got to be open to the repercussions of it. I think a lot of people who complain about political correctness are just complaining because for the first time in their life and in sometimes history, their particular beliefs are being criticized when they express them, mm-hmm. right?
So they're not really, you know, upset about, oh, well, I should be able to say everything that I should be able to say the things that we used to say, you know, uncriticized, you know? That's it. Yeah,
I read the article that John Cleese that like touched base on what he said, and after that I was like, wait, like, have you like had anyone ever told you like one joke that you told was bad, or like anyone ever make you feel embarrassed in public for something you said? Like, that happens to everyone, and then that's like an experience you should have. And I was like, it's not anyone's right to be like, well, like, I should be able to say whatever I want and no one can ever say anything about it because I'm so cool. And I was like, I was like, you can say whatever you want, and someone's always gonna be like, dude, I don't know, like, or dude, you're making a fool of yourself. Like, when that happens, you need to be okay with it, because like, I mean, everyone does that once in a while. It's not a big deal. So I think there's a lot of people who have to come out as being really sensitive, fragile people. I was like, I am so sorry. I never saw you that way.
Oh, those are all the opinions on... No, I'm just kidding. That's all for that.
Please, you know, like, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody knows that.
Yeah. Is he here? yeah, I guess, let's see. Well, so in terms of like community, there's the, because I had to learn how to pronounce this word correctly. Angoulême. Yes. I was close. There was a little N in there that I didn't, there was a little inflection that I almost had. Okay, yeah, yeah. So they had like the, you know, the International Comics Festival, I guess like the Grand Prix. Like Lifetime Achievement Award. And for people that don't know...
It's pricks.
Oh. Okay. Hey, you know what? You know what? Hey, I was close. I was so close. Is Lifetime Achievement also pronounced that way? So yeah, they had like 30 candidates, and apparently...
Lifetime Achievers are also pricks.
Yeah, that's how you pronounce every word. So apparently none were women. Like, none. And I kind of like, I researched a little bit. Apparently, they've only awarded like, or I guess nominated one woman.
Yeah.
I think, like, it's just in the history since like 74.
One woman has won.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah. And so, you know, they had that. I think 12 nominees were in protest. I think retracted. And then, like the committee kind of was like, okay, we'll nominate six women like. Like, here's six of, you know. And then they retracted that and then just let like professionals vote. So it's kind of like, the topic of like presumed credibility, I guess. And you, Ron, you brought up a good point about like, are we kind of naive to even expect institutions to be meritocracies to begin with?
Right.
Like, I mean, off the top.
Maybe you guys can say, you know, my bad.
Hey, man, you're ready.
Maybe you guys can help me out, because like, I would be interested in a counterpoint, because like, I just don't watch awards. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, and it's funny because like, I'm going to be maybe helping to judge something here, I think. And like, but I mean, I'm keep it 100. I don't give a fuck. You know, like, when have they ever, like, they're not a meritocracy, right? And then there's a discussion about, you know, affirmative action or whatever. And it's like, well, you know, is it going to be in a meritocracy, or are we just going to let these other people in? And it's like, well, you've been letting people in off of like poor merit already. Like, now you're just going to do it and they're going to be more diverse. You know what I mean? So like, what's the point? Like, so, I mean, if you guys care about awards, if you guys care about Angoulême or, you know, Harvey's or whatever, the, you know, like, what would you say to me to be like, well, maybe you should care about these Hollywood, you know, I never tried. I done all right. I don't care. I didn't go when I got nominated.
Yeah, I think for awards, as a young artist or when you're a student, I think there's a level of value to it. Like, people, you show up and people don't immediately trust you. Like, you are trying to establish some kind of credential. Like, when we were all sitting here before, like, we all have to say, like, what kind of work we do. Like, why are you sitting there listening to me talking about things? So, like, winning an awards or getting stuff, it's just like, if you're someone who shows up and people just don't trust you, like, that are, like, some of the things you can pull out of the bag and be like, look at all these shiny things that I get. And if you are catering to groups that believe in awards, it kind of, you know, like, it doesn't really matter whether you believe in them or not. It was like, yeah, I'm probably never going to get into Angoulême. Like, who cares? But if I'm talking to people every day who, like, really cares about it, they're like, why don't you have one of those things? And then it was like, well, it shouldn't matter so much because you're obviously biased and they're never going to give it to me. So you're in this, like, catch-22 where... I think the most effective thing to do for me is to come up with really great arguments of every time people mention that. I was like, this is why I think this shouldn't matter this much. And then why don't you look at my work and I can totally do what you asked me to do, which is how it happens most of the time anyway. But I think in school, or if you're trying to get scholarships or if you're trying to do stuff, like, there are definitely people who look at awards that stacks up.
Also, I think when you talk about meritocracy, you have to think about, like, okay, so I go to an art school that is a really great art school. I have the best teachers, I have the best resources, therefore I have a kind of a leg up when I have access to these things. Well, who's going to those art schools? What demographics are in those art schools? Which demographics are getting access to these resources? So meritocracy doesn't just start and stop and is maybe a farce in this kind of institution. It goes so deep, right? It goes throughout our entire society. I think there are functions to institutions like this where, yeah, you have to establish some level of credibility in terms of, I kind of know what I'm talking about, but also it has a history. This building has a history. The work has a history, et cetera. It may be something that we take issue with because people like us were not allowed to, or working in this industry for a while. But they do things like act as a bellwether for these types of social issues. Like, we are up on this stage at this institution talking about this stuff. So in that way, I think it serves as a kind of focus or focal point that has power. And I think that has a level of visibility that I think is very useful too. So that's not really a devil's argument, but there is something useful to these types of institutions. And part of that is trying to look at work and try to figure out what's good work or not. I think you can automatically throw out the idea that there's quality as the bellwether or the measure of the work. Because what's quality? Who gets to determine quality? Even when you talk about diversity, you talk about the authenticity of work. Who gets to determine authenticity? You can fake authenticity all day long. So there's a lot of issues that we have to, like, address and look at and think about when we're looking at these the prizes and all that stuff too.
And I think, you know, those kind of institutions have such a deep responsibility to really be inclusive. And I think Angoulême's response was a bit disturbing in that they didn't really admit any culpability for their position. I think they really went wrong there. And I think what was also strange about it was that, you know, I think a lot of us could name so many female artists that deserve that award. And I know that, like, a lot of the response to what happened there is that people came out with lists of all of these incredible cartoonists, female cartoonists that have been working in the industry, Julie Doucet, like all of these people that people really respect that didn't even make that list. And, you know, clearly the people that are making that decision don't see the value in creating that kind of diversity and inclusion, and it's to me it doesn't seem even like a issue of inclusion. It's just, you know, looking at who are major players in an industry and seeing it for what it is, and women artists are always part of that. So I just
There's a bit of irony. All right, so I was there. I was in Angoulême on residency. They had a Tove Jansson exhibition there. It was amazing. It's beautiful. If you don't know, she created Moomin, queer woman, like, amazing, very important illustrator. They had
they had a fucking exhibition there, right? As far as I'm concerned, she's never been nominated nor won. She's, you know, Jesus, she illustrated The Hobbit. Like, she, you know, Moomin is probably one of the biggest international, I mean, it's like Snoopy and Moomin.
Yeah, they have
you know?
They have like a whole like amusement park.
Yeah. Right?
Anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
So like, I can't, how do I take that serious? How do I take this award seriously? You know?
No, I want to add one more thing for awards like this. I think for cartoonists or illustrators who have it, or if you need it to get to a certain level of credibility, or if you need to teach, or like, no one can discredit you for having it or attending it or anything. It just like, if you didn't get it or whatever, I think I had just like a level of like realization. It was like, I don't know how valuable, you know, it really speaks to whether people would like your work, or whether you're going to have an audience, or if you're going to be successful. I don't know how relevant that is to actually anything, but if you have it, I think it's certainly very useful. And then and that's why it is sort of very evil when people selectively don't give them to women. So
I think we have.
Yeah, just curious, since Shannon, in your intro, you mentioned that you just got mm-hmm. into the student scholarship show. Just mm-hmm. maybe your thought as a student coming from that perspective.
I guess in that sphere, being a student, you definitely look for that validation. Like, getting into a show like that, you're just like, wow, like, I'm being validated now. Maybe someone's gonna look at me now. And I think what I want students to take away from that is, like, your validation doesn't come from other people validating you. Like, you need to validate yourself first. Even if I didn't get into the show, the work I'm making matters to me, and I know it's mattered to other people. It's mattered to the piece that got in has been brought up from people in Brazil. They came to me and they're like, hey, this is an issue that we're dealing with. This speaks to me. Other people have talked to me. And I don't think that validation needs to come from these higher ups that are always deciding what holds that value. I'm happy I got into the show. I'm really grateful, but I don't want these award shows to discourage people and have them kind of just give up their dreams or give up their ambitions to just continue to make work. So yeah, it's a lot of things when you're still in school, especially now when you're competing against everyone and you want to make it right out the gate. These award shows are kind of all right, well, you're already above everyone else. And that's kind of a toxic way of thinking, because you're pretty much saying what John's making is trash, or what
which
you're making is not trash, John.
which by the way, it is not. John's it actually not. Amazing. Everybody's amazing. Just
as for listeners who couldn't see
hypothetical.
His face.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah.
Like, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, this is the moderator speaking again for people online.
That was
Shannon. So we had a robot to be like Shannon, and then Richie, and then we start talking. In terms of the validation, I think it's definitely something that's because when you're in school, mm-hmm. that in itself is an institution.
Yeah.
And so the only thing you see is what comes after. So it's okay, school. Than society or mm-hmm. you know this group, whatever, and so I guess in terms of students, how people that don't go to school
mm-hmm.
And still want to be in it, I think they feel what's my connection, how do I just jump in if I'm not in school, I don't know, I'm trying to think of what how can we help them, how can we support them to make the jump.
Hey.
And introduce yourselves every time.
I'm Cathy.
Oh, hey.
I actually went to art school, but I went for sculpture. I guess, I don't know, this isn't very insightful. I just meet a lot of people at conventions. Mm-hmm. I just go to conventions, which is, so I live in a really cheap city, and I pay my living expenses are very low, so I can spend a lot of money traveling and stuff, which is kind of a choice I've made purposely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's not that.
Oh, that was insightful. that's a good
changing
tip.
The world here.
That's good. That's good.
Like Cathy, I didn't have a illustration background, so I'm actually a creative writing major. So when I got out of school, I was like, "Yo, I wanna draw pictures and get money for it." But what is that? What even is that? Like,
yeah.
My parents were very disappointed, and also it's coming from an Asian family, it's like also like a double disappointment, I guess. but something that I tapped into kind of early on, and something that I think is probably one of the core pillars of what we're talking about, is the establishment of this community that supports each other and supports ourselves in a lot of ways. So I was really lucky to have mentors that took time the other day and like, hey, this is what an invoice looks like. Like, just scratch my social off of it and my name, and then you can start using it. I was like, okay, cool. And so there's people along the way that took time out of their day to like show me the ropes. And I think that's one of the most important kind of precedents of illustration. I want to say American illustration, because you can track the lineage through who teaches who, you know. But it's passing what you know on to the next generation. And it doesn't rely on these institutions necessarily. People can reach out and get in touch with you, and people will take time out of their day to tell you what's up and to help you like they were helped as well. So that's also a double-edged sword too, because sometimes people will betray that, right? Sometimes people will be too busy, or they think they're above something, or that you don't have the credibility. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, I don't need to talk to this guy, he's not good.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, he doesn't have that, like, he didn't win the student award show because his work is trash. It's like, why should I help this guy? And that to me is like a betrayal of that that precedent, and that's really something we probably should like check ourselves a lot of times. You know, like, oh, this email, I don't wanna write this email to the student right now. It's like, yeah. Yo, come on, like, how long is it really gonna take?
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. I think.
Can you introduce yourself?
Oh, sorry. I'm Yao.
I was kidding.
And I have not introduced myself to any of the things I said. So if you sound, if you heard me, that's me speaking.
Hello, me.
Hi. I totally agree. I think for us to all learn more from what we have, we need to be not elitist about anything. Like, we can't, as professionals, can't be like, oh, that person's like a student, or like, that person didn't even go to art school, that person even didn't even go to school, I don't know why I'm talking to them. Or for students, if you like someone's work, you know, there are a lot of people with a lot of knowledge who is willing to give you all they know, and don't look at their awards, don't look at, like, you know, who they worked for, because you never know, like, what happens in people's lives. Maybe there are, like, choices that they made, they don't work for certain people. So you don't have to, because I feel like, people would flood to a certain direction, like, thinking they're gonna get what they want, but then, like, you know, people don't have time, or there are just so many professional illustrators out there who are like, I know all of this stuff, I need to give it to someone, otherwise it just like rots, and then like 5 years later, it's not relevant anymore. So, and then I would say, like, when you're asking for help, people are willing to help, but you kind of gotta like be a little more forward about it. You know, like, I'm not gonna write to students and be like, can I help you? But if you just like wrote me, like,
they'll be really excited. Like, wait, who's this?
Well, I think some people take like an extra step to like do like a call online, like, I'm ready to help you, like, send me your questions. But you do have to be a little more self-motivated too. But also for us who went to art school, sometimes it's just like a matter of like sharing what exactly you did in art school, because some people don't know. Like, a lot of it's like having that network or knowing certain people. And you don't really have to go to art school for it if you know that's exactly what it is. Question.
Yeah, I have a question sort of related.
Oh, can everybody hear?
He'll ask it, you kind of repeat it.
Okay, cool.
I have a question.
Hello.
You're talking about giving back. How many of you, or how do you give back? Do you have people specifically that you maybe mentor? How many of you have a mentor? I mean, I know some of you are pointing to some of these experiences, but I wonder how much of that has been formalized or done informally. And do you look for specific kinds of people to mentor? Does anybody ever come up and you're like, no, sorry, not you?
Okay, yeah. Yeah, so the question was, like, how do y'all How do y'all give back?
Yeah.
Yo, Tumblr. Tumblr is worth that. Like, actually, the ask function on Tumblr is probably the best the single most like useful part of Tumblr, because people can ask anonymously, but people can attach it to their blogs, whatever. And then once you answer that question, it becomes a self-encapsulated post, right? So for a while, my blog was 80% just fielding questions from students. Specifically, I was talking about my own experience. So I was talking about, like, again, Asian American experience and Asian American or Asian diaspora experience too. Talking about issues.
Excuse me, what's your Tumblr?
It's johndraws.tumblr.com. But I was speaking from my particular experience, and that automatically kind of attracted a certain type of person who was looking for that information. But it became a thing. Like, it became a thing that gained momentum, and people were sharing it. There was a dialogue. It became a very interesting place for them to reach me directly. And it was in a very public, open area, too, because it's on Tumblr, obviously. So that was really great. I don't know if you guys...
That was John, by the way. I think before I even met you, I think I followed your Tumblr, and I don't think I'd ever seen, like, I knew there was like the ask function. I just started my Tumblr, but like it's kind of like, even if no one asks you a question, it can be like almost like passive help just from like observing. Yeah. So you like there's people that might come up to you and ask or say like, oh, you know, thank you for this and that. But it wasn't something you consciously did. It was kind of just like, just the act of making and the act of being like visible as yourself.
Yeah, I definitely use Tumblr as much as possible. And sometimes, because I'm a sharer, I just volunteer information, mm-hmm. you know? I wish I got more asks, though.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, everybody, ask Ron, man. Yeah. Just ask him right now, you know? This is like a live Tumblr.
Yeah, yeah.
You ask him right now.
Don't get me started, though, because I'll be up here.
You could put on a mask. It'll be anonymous, you know? Repeat the same things.
There's a question. There's like two questions.
They can come up and talk.
Yeah, if you guys want to come up.
I've heard you on like a podcast like talking about difficulties that you had like, Marvel and DC.
Mm. Are we going to go there?
This is like an important question. I mean, like, how comfortable are you to talk? I mean, we're talking about diversity, especially like criticizing the major people who like commission work. Like, do you have like an idea about a line that you cross, or like, where do you know?
So, repeating the question, pretty much, you know, work with Marvel, DC, the big, you know, big companies, you know, but like what lines are, you know?
I mean, my answer is four words long. I don't give a fuck. I don't know, maybe.
That's four.
Yeah, maybe you don't see me working with them ever again. But like, if they're gonna create an environment where certain behavior is acceptable, then like, I don't wanna fucking work with them. Like, it's that simple. Like, it's easier for me to say because I'm in a place now where, okay, I get work from other people. Mm-hmm. You know, like, it was different when I was starting out, you know, and I feel like even on the inside, back then it was kinda like, I don't know. You take some bullshit, but like then when you get to a position where you have people listening and you can actually, you know, buck back like you do, you know, and that's the privilege. You get to a place of privilege, then you pass that shit down, you know. So that's how I feel about it. And I don't give a fuck.
Ron. Ron Wimberly. And also, that was five words. I'm sorry. That was, I don't give a, that was five. I'm sorry. That was five. That was five. I thought it was four too, but
okay, this is Yao. To answer that question, I definitely answer people's emails all the time, and I do talk to people who teach at school, who I'm like, can I come talk to your students about stuff, because they're about to graduate and they're all freaking out, and you don't know why they're freaking out, but I know why they're freaking out, so I want to go talk to them, and maybe they can like have a little better time than I had when I was graduating. Speaking at places, it's a great way to say something once and then like more than one person can hear it. That's really like, I think, the function of these things. It yeah, it's not like just people like to sit at podiums and yap all day, but I just like, you know, if you can like set a place and time, people who want to know these things, they come and they hear it and they tell like 50 other people, that would be really great. And also whenever I talk to someone who's a student, I'm like, you know, if you need to talk to me anytime, if you have any questions, or like if you see me at society, like definitely say hi, or like if you like you have an online presence, let's be friends, because this is how people network and this is how people get work. So I definitely make that really clear, like you can definitely do that.
I wanted to talk on how we give back and stuff.
Shannon.
Shannon. Shannon speaking now. For me, at my school, I have different organizations set up, and I always make it open to have different people contributing. I work for my newspaper as like the illustrations editor, so I'm always open for other people to get into illustration. And some of them come to me and they're like, hey, I've never done this illustration before, and I straight up say, I am here to help you get there. Here's my number, here's my email, like we can get there together, we can bounce ideas off of each other. And I don't ever want them to be in a place where they feel like they can't do it because they don't have like the access or just the knowledge to do such things. So I think it's a matter of making yourself available and putting that time aside. I definitely try to put that time aside. I mean, sometimes I've gotten like text messages at like 2 a.m. and they're like, I'm just having difficulty. Huh?
How'd I get your number?
I mean, Facebook is a real thing. Yeah. But it's just like putting yourself out there, maybe making these workshops available, say, hey, I'm available during these times and these times to consult and maybe just talk a little bit. I think a lot of students, and I'm just going to speak on students, just want to have that time to talk. And they don't want to feel like they're being pushed aside or what they're asking isn't of importance. So even if it's just like 30 minutes and they're like, hey, I'm having difficulties with this, I don't know how to approach this subject matter, or I just need help, I think it's our job to maybe put a little bit of time aside, even if it's just an email, to like help them through it a little bit, you know, just give back. Someone mentioned like when you get to that level of privilege, you have to like pass that down, and you just like, it's like you get into the door and then you try to help other people get into the door, and then it's like a chain reaction, a domino effect. And I think that's how we have to like set this society up and this community up, where it becomes that community sphere where we're helping each other and not just like it's all about myself and stuff. And I can go into like ally stuff and all those other things, but
all the other stuff.
Well, also just like a quick note too, it's an artist's responsibility in terms of community. I would say that that's not really the artist's responsibility. Like they don't have to do that. So like Talib Kweli says, artist's only responsibility is to be honest, right? And what that means is different for everybody. So whether that means I'm honestly reflecting my roots and I had a community that built me up, therefore I have to pay back, that's me, that's my prerogative. Somebody else might be like, I'm just gonna write all day and like fuck everybody, you know, like that's also their prerogative, they're making work, okay, whatever. But people are people, and our community is comprised of people, and we have different levels of honesty that we are bringing to the table, I think. So that's the only responsibility that I think we should have.
Yeah, okay.
And I think on that point,
this is Odera.
Odera. I think on that point, mentoring comes in a lot of different ways. Like you can mentor like by telling people and teaching people things, but also in your work, you can actually physically mentor. For instance, you can have representation in your work, and that alone is enough. That can be your truth. I think in this community specifically, mentoring is so crucial. Mark Sheff, who asked that question, is my mentor, and I don't think I would be here in this illustration community to that capacity without him. And recently, I guess you could say sharing is caring, because this February I was like, it's Black History Month, we gotta spotlight Black illustrators, and I didn't really expect it to like blow up or become this big thing, but on the first day it was like 2,000 retweets of Thomas Blackshear's illustrations. So I think a really easy, palpable way to give back is simply sharing other people's work and showcasing them and being like, I'm great, other people are great.
Yeah, this is Cathy.
Hey.
Yeah, and that's the question, kind of going back around to why things like Angoulême are a problem, is because like, how are you supposed to know? Depending on, I guess the internet kind of makes isolation less of a thing, but like, how are you supposed to know who to ask if the big names that are winning awards are all people that you can't relate to, mm-hmm. is kind of why that might be an issue. Angela.
Yeah. You do? Yeah. Do you want to come up and then ask?
Not exactly a question, just a remark.
Okay.
Ron?
Yep.
Yeah. I like your attitude. Like, fuck everybody.
No, it's not fuck everybody.
You know, there's don't give a fuck and fuck everybody. I think, you know, it's an in-between.
Project that.
But for the most part, I've heard a discussion here about, like, what kind of things or actions, like, a young professional or a young illustrator that just, like, finished school or didn't finish school will need to do in order to step it into the industry. So I'm not a professional illustrator like you. I'm just like doing some underground things. I'm from the security industry, so I'm not related to this industry that much. But I would say that any professional, regardless is like occupation, should be in general focused like in two lanes. One lane is just like the professionalism, how technical he is, like develop his style, develop his like say, if it's agenda or I don't know, artistic style. But at the same time, he just have to work on his like marketing skills. And when I'm saying marketing, it's not like put like publish on Facebook, yeah, I'm the coolest artist in the world or whatever. He's definitely should go to some events like he should definitely go some events and introduce himself. Furthermore, you have to go to events where key personnel in this industry and furthermore are like.
Sorry, I don't want to interrupt. If you want to come up and if you want to use the mic, because I think people at home are kind of trying to listen out, they might not be able to hear you.
Oh.
Yeah, you come up. That's fine. Yeah. Come on down.
You're on
him. No.
Oh, yeah, thank you. I appreciate it. What's your name?
Shannon.
Hey, what's up?
So I'll introduce quickly myself. I'm Elad, not US based, as you might hear according to my name. But I just mentioned like a quick remark here that people were developed a kind of discussion what young people or beginners in this industry have to do to make in order to step it up and just like start to polish themselves, getting new jobs or whatever. So regardless if you guys are illustrators or young artists or professionals like these people are, if you are a professional, regardless your occupation, this is just like my perspective about it. First of all, I believe that you have to work on your professional side, like how good you are in art, your style, your character, like the way you're doing techniques and stuff like that. And from the other lane, I definitely believe that people should like working on their marketing skills, which means that, as Cathy have mentioned, she's not here, she's gone.
I think she took a break.
Elvis have left the building. But you definitely have to go to conventions. Furthermore, you definitely have to talk with key personnel in this specific industry, because of course there is like a community responsibility, as these professionals were saying and mentioned here, but there is also the personal responsibility. Like every person have to take action and be responsible for himself in one way or another, to motivate himself, to push himself, to, I don't know, contact with these professionals or whatever that makes him one step further into this industry. Furthermore.
I'm sorry, I don't want to interrupt you, but I'd really like to hear the panel.
You had a question for Ron, didn't you?
Yeah.
No, I just like want to put in a remark there.
Oh yeah, sure. I think we actually have an online question. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I can read it to you.
Okay.
Well, can I get a response real quick? Just on.
Can talk about it.
Oh, okay. So you're not wrong, right? It is.
Yeah, that's fine.
There is a professional aspect. There is a marketing aspect. There are all these things that we have to do to be professionals. But I think the reason we're up on the stage too is that sometimes that's really hard when you're coming from a marginalized standpoint, right? It's really hard to be a person sometimes. It's really hard to be a professional sometimes if you're not treated like those things, if you're not raised like those things, if you're not in those atmospheres at that time. It's so difficult to act like a human being when you're not treated like a human being sometimes. Yeah. So, yes, I mean, it's like James Baldwin was saying. He says, I just want to write, but there's this problem that's like weighing down me at all times. How do I reconcile with that? How do I deal with that? And this is what we're talking about. We're talking about community. These are the people that we're trying to uplift. These are the people that we're trying to find, and we're trying to like tell their stories and let them tell their stories too. So you are not wrong. You're absolutely not wrong about the marketing and the professional aspect. But it goes so deep. Like it goes so deep in the layers to this problem, quote unquote. I don't know. That it's not just a slick marketing campaign. It can't be.
Okay, so I just want to make a remark, because this is kind of my whole spiel too. It's like, yeah, you gotta
have. And this is Yao.
Oh, this is Yao speaking. So you've gotta work on your work, and then you have to also have marketing skills. That's like the basics of what everyone does anyway. So the stuff that we were talking about right now is like, at some point, like your work is like absolutely perfect. Like when I'm talking to people and when I'm marketing myself, it's like, I've made the best work I can possibly make. It doesn't get any better at this second. This is like, there's no, like at this moment, this is like what I'm selling. I'm totally confident and I've worked on my personal skills. Like this is like beyond what you have already done. So I would say like that's a good point. If you feel like your personal skills needs brush up, like by all means, that's part of the job. So like that's nice. But I'm just saying the things that we're talking about right now, it's once you have done all of your homework, there are other stuff that yeah.
So yeah, absolutely. yeah, that's level one. You need to do that. So
Ron Wimberly.
Ron, yeah.
Ron.
Absolutely, level one, you have to have that. That just means that you are a professional or an aspiring professional if you haven't gotten paid for it yet, right? You're a professional. Moving on from there, humanizing yourself in those spaces, that is a discussion to have. You have to be, assertiveness is required, but at the same time, you have to steel yourself against the pushback that you'll receive. And I mean, this is gonna sound maybe kind of like, I don't know. You need to invest in kind of humanizing yourself outside of that space, believing in yourself outside of that space, surrounding you with people who can, when you leave that space, before you go into that space, like those people support you, you know? And you
like,
can
like not just doing it just like, oh, I need assignments, I need to, but just like, just living, just yeah. in general, just life in
yeah.
general.
Life yeah. in general, and like kind of surrounding, you know, what is it? The I'll be your mirror, like that, you know, like keep people around you who reflect that humanity back to you. So when you go into those spaces that are, you know, caustic, you can come back, or you can like, you know, you can rely on that support. I think is, for me, that's very important, you know?
I think we have a question. We have questions for everywhere, so we'll get to every as many people as we can.
So, should I read it?
Yeah, sure.
I got, I have a question from the podcast chat, and it's, as a transgender student in an illustration department managed by a lot of cisgender heterosexual old white men, how can students best carve out their own spaces in schools for art and making that aren't defined by the older generation's ideals for their students of sticking to the script, being professional, and following in the tradition of illustration? We got another one after that.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was going to get to. I was going to talk about like the role of teachers in like canon and classics, like what they show you versus like maybe what you're into, and you know, the disparity, like when those things don't line up.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that comes up now.
This is Yao.
This is Yao. I am so bad at this. You would eventually the one last person who doesn't say her name is me.
It's an unnatural way to talk. Like, this is me again.
It's like a huge international conference call or something. So one thing that is it just comes up in art school now because we do have a pretty big generation gap between students and teacher because students get younger and younger and time moves faster in a young person's life. So every year everyone feels a little more depressed about how they're being treated in school. And a lot of things that everyone thought was okay before, like it's never been okay. And then teachers are freaking out, like, why isn't this okay? And students are like, why are you treating me that way? And I think it is really difficult, but I think two things might help with someone who's in school right now. For one, like when someone is telling you that you are just like making a fuss, you're like being depressed for no reason, like you can't believe that what they're saying is true. It's completely BS. And then another thing is that you are in a really unique position where you will be disbelieving everything that people say to you, which is a very great way to live. Like, basically, people are gonna tell you a lot of things, and you have the right to be like, actually, you're wrong, and probably no one has told you that you're wrong before. I am that person. I'm sorry, this is gonna happen for you this year, next year, for your entire life. People are gonna start telling you that you're wrong, and then you are part of that.
Might as well start it right now.
Yeah.
It's gonna come up again.
Yeah, so there's some, it just like, and there are other people who are outside of school who will support you. So I'm just going to say you're not alone if you're feeling that way. It can easily happen in art schools, especially not in New York. And then you're not easily reachable by people who are not in your city, who are not in your school.
Yeah. Are you saying they're not alone in being wrong? Like, are you still explaining to that person?
Oh, that too.
You will find that people agree with you. You're still wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah, even if a ton of people are agreeing with you, you are still
support
wrong.
Group, but
yeah. This is Odera. I can't speak specifically to trans issues, but I think it's important, no matter what, to carve out safe spaces for yourself. Maybe even more critical than the actual art school work that you're doing. I remember, this isn't trans related, but I went to RISD, which was 1% black. So by the end of our senior year, there was 10 other black people, two of them being an illustration with me. So I would literally go to Brown University, take African dance classes, do whatever I could to like find that community that I needed so that I could focus on work. And some people would be like, okay, you're like spending 4 hours at Brown every weekend and you should be in studio. And I was like, yeah, but I also need to see other black people, period. So I think it's just important to create those spaces that you can heal in and thrive in.
Yeah, I think it's hard to.
This is Cathy.
Know this. You're Richie. I'm Cathy.
Yes.
I think it's really hard to. Because when you're in school, a lot of the times you're very young, you're freshly not a teenager anymore, and it's hard to realize that your life is not school. And that also schools love to make it seem like you can only be in the school campus and you have to do all the campus activities and you can't go anywhere else. But usually schools are in a city, and finding a life and finding an art community outside of your school community can be very healthy, especially if you have teachers who have priorities and ideals that aren't yours. So finding another community is like super important, like creating safe spaces. I went to MICA and I would take Johns Hopkins classes to get off campus. And also to also realize school, what your art assignments. I mean, I was a sculpture major, which is kind of boring, but I learned how to create. I learned like metalwork and I learned carpentry, and I don't do that for my art career anymore. So like what you learn in school can be important, and what your teachers prioritize, you can learn, but you can also try to be true to yourself and keep in mind that what your assignments are not you. So.
Question. Want to come up and ask? For anyone who can't see, someone's walking up to the stage there, and they grab the mic. Okay, here we go.
I guess this is sort of a hypothetical question, but if you're a person coming from a certain level of privilege, whether it's your gender, your race, or sexuality, or whatever, what qualities do you think would make you be a better mentor or teacher to someone who's different from you?
It's part of the diversity conversation. This is John. It's part of the diversity conversation that we need to be having too, in terms of people that do have privilege, like people that, because we all in our ways have certain types of privileges that can be actionable in certain unique ways. And as the demographics of the nation and our industry change, like that's going to change as well. People will have certain amounts of privilege. So how do you leverage that to help others too? So I think it's like utilizing understanding like the context of where you sit in the room and what you can do to help people that are like you, and how there are intersectional relationships between certain issues that you can highlight and that you can work for. So as artists, though, I think like this kind of goes back to the previous conversation of where do you find places outside of art school or your businesses or whatever, like artists and activism, that's kind of a tricky intersection, because like artists make really shitty activists sometimes because we're too busy like drawing on our tables and we don't know how to organize necessarily. We don't necessarily know how to bring people together. Sometimes we would just rather sit in our rooms, right? But at the same time, you can have an activist kind of mindset or activist facet to your practice that is separate from your artistic practice too. So you can start to network with different groups. You could find places where there are people that share your interests and you can insert yourself there. Like I can maybe teach somebody how to draw. Like that is a skill that I bring to the table. And I can go to perhaps like the Asian American Arts Alliance or whatever and be a mentor in that capacity. So it's identifying what you're good at, I think. That's part of what illustration is about, right? You have to find your voice, you have to find your edge. You have to find out like what, you have to be kind of introspective. You have to be kind of observational. You have to know yourself. And you have to leverage those things. And I think that the more that you know yourself and the more that you know the historical context of that, the better you are in the position to help people. So, but I don't think everybody can do everything. And I think that like that's totally fine, right?
Yeah. Sorry.
I just wanted to,
I mean,
like, for example, Odera, like, your mentor appears to be not Nigerian or
Chiyama's question was, I know it in my head, but I can't say it again.
What made this mentor, you know, given that they maybe come from a different background, maybe has like privilege that you don't, what made them a good mentor for you?
Yeah.
Or not? Yeah.
I think in the most simple terms, one of the most important traits is empathy. And realizing that even though you have privilege, you're never above anyone, whether it's a child, a student, someone older than you. If you have privilege, then that's just the perspective that you have, and you have something that you can teach and give to them. So you just have to have empathy and not really assume things. Because at the end of the day, we all just want to draw pictures as a living, so it's not.
Yeah. This is Richie, the mod. This is me. Yeah, in terms of like, I saw something, or I listened to it. It was Charlie Kaufman speaking, I think, to BAFTA. She was speaking about screenwriting. It was really brilliant because he was like, I'm not going to tell you how to write screenplays. I don't,
like the way I write is just that would be telling you like what I'm doing. But he did say about where he starts screenplays and like storytelling, and I think his whole point was, he's like, you know, I like what I know is what I know, but I still don't know anything. Like he started off with, like, I don't know anything. Like I learned something today, and then tomorrow I might be like, oh, okay, well, you know. So I think there's a certain like pride to have in yourself, but also maybe, you know, a certain like humility of like, okay, this is what I know right now, but you know, maybe next year, the year after, like I'm always, there's always gonna be something else. So I think that's something, you know, important to have for like the identity to be a mentor. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I guess also there's always, no matter what, common ground to be found between people. And it just is a question of what questions you ask or how you choose to approach a relationship with somebody. But I also just wanted to remark that, you know, I'm coming from a perspective as an art director, which I think is very much a kind of mentorship position, or at least that's how I view it, in that it is essentially collaborative. You are working in collaboration with an artist, and you are working together as a unit to try to produce excellent work, both from the position of, you know, whatever publication it is, but also for the artist to try to get their best work into the world. And so, you know, just over the past 5 years working in this position, I do, and I've also taught as well, and I see this real similarity between these two roles of being a teacher, a mentor, and an art director. And I guess it's just important to view art direction in that way, because essentially all illustrators end up working with an art director. And I think empathy in that role is very important as well, in terms of understanding where an artist is coming from, what experiences they're bringing to it, what their interests are as a person. And I think to be able to make assignments as an art director for illustrators, so that they can approach topics from a perspective of truly caring about what they're doing. To me, that's very important.
It's very specific though. Like, I mean, it's, or, so for me, and I don't know how good I am at it, but I, you know, I try to continue to be better at it. You know, compassion, empathy, absolutely. One of the things, I think it comes back to the safe space. So like, okay, creating a space where someone who maybe has a different, you know, like maybe a different sort of walk than I have, maybe has to deal with like being open to the idea of like maybe there's this person is bringing more to this experience than I'm seeing, even like, so in terms of like marketing and promotion, like, you know, I can't necessarily say that to someone. Like maybe I'm dealing with someone who has some sort of a trauma, or they're experiencing the world, it, like I don't even see the barriers, you know, like, so for me, I just walk into a room and I'm like, yeah, I gotta pop and let's go, you know what I mean? But for them, they may have, it's different. Like they're looking at a room full of people who are, you know, maybe like throwing darts, like violence, all types of things at them that I don't even see. So like what I try to do is I try to create a space, whether it's a dialogue about the work, about procedures, about like price, about all of that, where we can kind of like play that out in a safe space. So that later on they can do it and try not to be frustrated if I feel like, you know, yo, why didn't you do that though? Like I told you, like this is what you need to do. Like kind of being open-minded about maybe I don't see the whole picture, you know. And actually in a case of, I think, all mentorships, what's really important is you're learning something from that person too. You know what I mean? Like it's a two-way dialogue. So I think what makes any mentorship good, like even if you have a type of privilege that the other person doesn't, is that like, okay, well, you're learning some shit, and be quiet, you know, and listen, you know.
Yeah, I was, oh, do you have something else to add? Yeah?
Yeah, I want to add a little, because I've definitely, this is Yao speaking.
Just in case you didn't hear it so, the first time.
When I started out, even when I was in school, I definitely had a lot of help from people who were my mentors. And I would just say it's very hard to
especially if you're in a specific space, you can seek out people who are exactly like you, but sometimes you are where you are and freaking out about all of this stuff because there are not a lot of people who are like you. And I think from the mentor and the person being mentored, you have to keep an open mind, and that's why you can't just make anyone your mentor, or you can't just like take someone under your wing, be like, you are like my student now or whatever, like you, and then you
just grab them. Yeah,
yeah, you can't just be like, you look like you're cool, I want me to mentor you so I can like own your success or whatever. So like so you kind of have to meet the right person who like they let you be you, but you also let them be them, and it's a relationship that grows. So you might have different ideas about things when you first meet because you're different people, and later it might change the both of you. And that's I think the beautiful thing about having our job as something in common, because you can always relate something back to something that you both know. So I think it's definitely very helpful. Like, I'm happy to like mentor someone who's Asian, who's a woman, who's queer, but like, do I really have to, like, that's gonna be like me assuming because we have the same labels, you are me, I'm you. Like, that's, yeah, like, dangerous. Yeah, and it's very dangerous.
And the help itself might be, yeah, it's like relative sometimes.
Yeah, like, it's only relative. So, and then you might come to someone who's like, wait, I think you're just like me, and then they are not like you at all. And then you demand them to be more like you because you think you share the same labels, and then, like, it doesn't always happen.
Yeah, another question?
Yeah, I got a question.
Okay, sure, sure.
We got a question on Twitter from Martin G, who's an illustrator and art director. He said, what do you tell teachers tired of political correctness / walking on eggshells who feel like they can't criticize a student or their work? Then he says, should we work from within to create change? He also comments that he works at Time magazine. Time did a story about more diversity at Marvel, and diversity can make money too.
Well, that's
yeah.
That's certainly the angle, right?
Yeah. Who wants to go first on this? I feel like everybody has. Okay.
Just like go down the line.
Okay. All right. Ron.
All right. Okay. So, but. All right. Like, so what, Ronald? So, like, what I was saying before was, you know, when, you know, I have a buddy of mine who's a professor, and like, yo, he's a radical. Like, he's a punk, right? Like, an OG punk from like the mid 70s, right? Also a person of color, right? And he was speaking to me, and he's like, man, I never thought that I would get to a point where I would feel like I'm the square guy in the room, like I'm the man, like I'm the establishment, like I don't know what's going on, like, you know, everyone's queer, like this, that, and the third, and like I don't know like which adjectives, pronouns to use, you know what I mean? And it's like, but from a position of like, yo, I want to do right, but I also feel like I'm caged, right? And I'm like, yo, dude, but here's the thing, man, like you're feeling, the feeling that you're having is actually like, you're experiencing what these people always feel. So like now at this point in time in history, like we're getting to a point where if you've always had the privilege to just kind of like be a bull in a china shop and like, yo, I'm just me, like a big swinging dick, like I do this, you know, like, you know, now all of a sudden it's like, oh, well, maybe I should, you know, like everyone, and as a person of color, like you can kind of vibe with that. You can understand like, okay, well, there was a time, maybe it's a little safer for me in this space now, but there was a time where I felt kind of cloistered and like, I can't be myself, I can't say that. And kind of to activate that space in a helpful way is to make like, you know what, if, you know, if I'm gonna be uncomfortable, like we all about to be uncomfortable, you're gonna make a mistake, you're gonna learn today, you're gonna learn actually how to make me feel safe in this space, right? And like, that's what they need to understand. It's like, just because people are not being politically correct doesn't mean that, you know, he's being offended now or he feels out of, you know, out of place now. But people were always feeling out of place. People were always, you know, feeling the way he feels now is what, I don't know if I'm putting it properly. I don't know if you get what I'm saying. Yeah.
Yeah, you said every word that you said I wanted to say too. It was super great. This is Yao too. And you guys are going to laugh at me every time. No.
It breaks any tension, you know, any awkwardness.
Yeah.
Say your name every time.
Yeah, so I totally agree. In school, it's a feeling that a lot of people would have, and since they are still living and they're still working, you can see that it would not like just ruin your life, and then there is a certain level of like people feeling now less human for if their label is a straight white guy. I've definitely seen people just being really, really, really bummed out about it. It was like, I'm sorry, but this is like change that you are experiencing in your lifetime, like in your generation. This is like a thing that is happening now, and you're feeling your resistance to it, and this is normal. Like you're not alone. So I think for teachers in general, or anyone who has this kind of concern, I think we do like acknowledge like this is also a human experience, because as we humanize ourselves as marginalized people, like we do need to also consider other people as people. And then people do have a natural reaction to resistance when they feel like everybody hates them. So I can't say that, oh, because you're a straight white guy, like you're not a person, you don't have feelings, and whatever you're doing right now, you're just like a walking stereotype of your privilege, and I don't care if anything that comes out of your mouth. That's like also not something that I do.
Yeah, actually, this is Richie the mod. I actually want to jump, like how smooth that was? Yeah. Also want to jump in just because it's kind of like, I kind of think about like, if someone's carrying like 100 pounds, like a million pounds their whole life, and someone has never carried any of that like specific weight. Yeah, yeah.
It's like, yo, carry a pound.
Yeah, carry a little bit. And then someone grabs like 5 of those pounds. They're like, oh my God, so heavy. And it feels like that. And it's like, they don't understand because they haven't felt it. So they're just kind of looking like, oh, I'm also carrying something. You know, it's like not being specific. And I think what Yao was talking about is it's kind of like the idea of, essentially like the idea of diversity as like change, when it's like diversity is natural. Mm-hmm. So it's like you're not changing to a new world. You're just changing. You're getting rid of the stuff that's actually not real in a way. Yeah.
Yeah, I always use the analogy of like someone walking and then someone's like driving in a tank. And it was like, yeah, walking. People are like, oh my God, walking is so tiring. You're like on your feet. I was like, yeah, you know, like this is how people walk. And you're just driving a tank the whole time. And
No. People drive everywhere,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. And then like when they get out of it, they're like, man, like air smells bad. Like I have to like be on my feet. Like this is like, I don't know. Like I don't
rocks
like
on the
this.
Ground.
Yeah. I was like, if you are like not in your tank all the time, maybe we can like all ride bicycles, but you're like not going back into your tank, and then we don't have enough tanks for everyone. Like that's another it's like another thing. People are like, I want to stay where I am in my privilege. I just want like you all to like be where I am. Like everyone should be treated like me. It was like the way you're treated is not natural. Like it's yeah,
except the tank is made
up. I love that analogy. So how do you get out of the tank?
Yeah, Mark in the audience asked, how do you get out of the tank?
Well, you open a latch first, like at the top, and then you like
yeah,
at the top.
Like
you like push-ups. You have to do some push-ups first. Yeah, maybe. But I think like to speak to that, like teaching's hard, right? Teaching should be hard. And I think if somebody comes up like, yo, I don't know how to critique this person, but you're critiquing them on the basis of their labels, or you don't know, you're tiptoeing on eggshells or whatever. It's like, are you really trying to help this person make the best art that they can? Like, are you looking at this image and saying like, okay, what is your intent for this image? What what kind of story are you trying to tell? Like, how can I best help you tell this story? And man, that's like, teachers need to realize that's part of teaching, right? Like, yeah. You don't go up there and just like, you have this position, you have this cool hat, or you have all of the tassels and stuff. Yeah, but no, it's you're helping these kids, right? They're looking to you to better themselves, right? So that's very difficult. To speak to the diversity in the economics issue too, like that's also a big thing. I can't stand it, man, when people are like, it needs more diversity. Mm. What does that mean, man? Like, what does that mean?
It's like a seasoning.
Yeah, but like client, well.
It's like a dash.
Yeah. Well, so I, you know, sometimes I get that in client work, right? They're like, it needs more diversity. It's like, well, what does that mean? They're like, well, make that person black. I'm like, oh, it's a one person, like one black person at a wedding. How about I make the entire wedding black?
Yeah.
And they're like, no, that's I'm like, well, it's like, yo, you should have told
it's a
me.
Black wedding.
Right. But the reality of it too, like, so to speak to like an Asian, specifically a Chinese standpoint, like, in Hollywood, they're realizing that, oh man, China is a huge industry, right? There's a huge film industry that we can tap into. There's like, maybe we can start putting some Chinese people into films and like start making money, like in China, by workshopping these things and realizing that, oh, Chinese people would like to see themselves on screen. It's like, yo, me too. Like Chinese American, hello, yeah, like, so, but there's a weird dichotomy where it's like, I realize it's for economic purposes. I, at the bottom line, this is gonna help sell more movies. But if it gets like a couple Chinese American people into the film, and it gives them opportunity, and that opens the door, I kinda have to live with that evil. And it kinda sucks, right? But it kinda sucks, but it's also like, at least it's happening.
But
I don't know.
I think it also comes back to the means of production, right? Like, is what I wanted to talk about. It's like, okay, well, yeah, you could put avatars or you can put whatever you actors in there, you know what I mean? But like, you know, what about the writer? What about the producer? You know, like you have to change things in the production, like the editors. Yeah. You have to change that, you know, to, or else it's just like, I don't know, there's a spectacle of diversity, right? Like, so, well, this is good branding. This is good, you know. We're looking after the market because, like, well, yeah, we want Chinese dollars, but do we really want to like pay people to to build this? Do we want to give the agency to the filmmakers or to the cartoonists who are going to put out their story? Nah, not really. You know, like that's a complete paradigm shift. No, what they'd rather do is put like, you know, chunky style, tomato, you know, like whatever, you know, like different, you know, and that's good for their brand, you know, like,
yeah.
I mean, it's
that's pretty much, I mean,
you know, like creamy vodka, marinara, you know, like that's all it is, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I was actually going to ask about like the idea of like, could we all talk about like content and like, oh, we made this, you know, it's always like, oh, don't make this character like black or Asian, whatever. Or like, oh, it's good that they made this character black or whatever. But it's kind of like, do you think it's like indicative of like, people argue like whether the images are powerful, but like everybody knows the positions are powerful, you know?
I think everyone's so scared to be labeled a racist or labeled a sexist. They're more scared of being labeled the certain thing than actually changing themselves to be anti-racist, anti-sexist.
Clap all the time, yeah.
And I want to add something. This is Yao. I think in a capitalist market, there's like a certain kind of respect that you know that someone is giving you when they're like, your demographic group is driving the economy right now. Like, people who are like, you have money now to buy things, and we haven't been making things that you buy, and then we are freaking out, so we're making all of them right now because your money is going elsewhere, we don't know where. So there's like a lot of brands caught on the LGBT train last year, with some people did it really badly, some people did it really well. But the nightmare is just like, well, you know, when the diversity train is gonna fade? Like, what if like, you know, all the Asian women are always poor, and then you are just never in any films? Like, it is, and I think it needs to, like you said, the content is one thing, but then whoever's actually making it, like, they need to be getting the job so they have the money so that they get more respect.
A unique, you know, something that's interesting when you said that. Well, if your person or your identity is a valuable commodity even outside of you, like if you're an Asian woman, like maybe you don't want to be in the books the way they want to put you in the books. Yeah. You feel me? So like, just being there is not necessarily a good thing, you know? Like, Birth of a Nation probably had some black actors in it.
It did.
You know?
Yeah, during some scenes.
I always say that.
Yeah.
They were working though.
I wanted to speak on something. Yeah. This is Shannon. I always get kind of like skeptical when I see like a black person in a movie that I'm like, wait, I feel like they were just like forced in this movie. I was like,
it's like a long shot.
Yeah, it's like a long shot. And then I'm like if you're making these movies, and we're just gonna stay on the like movie topic. If you're making these movies to meet a quota, you're kind of like not getting the point of it. Like, yeah, just because you're like putting this like token black person or token like Asian person or gay person or just anyone in these movies to be like, see, I did it. Like, I'm all for diversity. Like, are you really for diversity? Are you really? And it's that term diversity again.
It's so tricky because it's like, it's wide enough.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have an online question.
Have you ever felt like you've been hired because of your identity and not because of your portfolio, and then felt the same thing as an illustrator?
Yes. Yeah. Black History Month. Yes. Yeah, I kind of get nervous around. It's still February.
Isn't it like an extra day too?
Yeah,
it's an extra day this year.
It's a leap year. But yeah, I get extra nervous, and I kind of noticed it this month. I try not to, but you were getting like more jobs, and I was like, wait, something's different. Like, oh wow, it's Black History Month, and then you want to step back and tell them, you know, I work the rest of the year. But it's kind of frustrating. It's really frustrating that you're getting hired for these jobs because you're like, well, we need that black person to do this Black History Month thing or this like racial based or I'm getting worked up now.
Well, just real quick, like, to tie it back specifically to illustration, we were talking about these movie issues, and then also the tokenism that happens when you know, it's really difficult because the trouble with identity politics is that it becomes personal, right? And if it bleeds into your work, then it is in your work, and then people are looking at that and identifying with you. But the problem is that there isn't enough imagination to think that an Asian person can put their pencil on the paper and then not make like an Asian-y thing or like a black thing. Yeah. Or we get put into these boxes simply because of the identity, but simply because the cultural production is not there to realize that the second my pencil touches that paper, it doesn't matter what I draw, it's Asian American art, period. Mm-hmm. It's black art, period. And it can be anything, right? Mm-hmm. So the power of illustration, I feel, and the power that we have in terms of creator-owned content is that we provide the imagination. We're not necessarily leaders, we're not politicians, we're not activists necessarily, but we provide imagination for people to see the possibilities. Yeah. And I think that's the important part.
You said something really great. But I would say that there's definitely that, and as an Asian illustrator, I would say, like, as illustrators, we work for content that's already been decided, so there's like quotas of like most of the articles that need Asian things are mostly foreign policy. So I would say like you're hired for your identity, but you know how many articles really are gonna be there in mainstream media about Asian Americans? So like it is like how you are, but if that's the box that you ended up putting into, like, are you gonna like go with the like how many articles are gonna be published about queer people of color, and then that's when you lose work, you know?
Yeah, I mean, do you have something?
Yeah, no, I was just gonna say it's a tricky thing,
Andrew.
You know. Yes, as someone who hires for editorial and frequently, you know, has to commission artwork for topics that are very specific. I do actually often think it's important to try to find an illustrator that can understand the issues within that article. And I don't mean like foreign policy, but I mean, you know, frequently I'm hiring for personal essays. And so actually one example is on the wall here, an artist, Jun Sen, who's Korean, and the author was Korean. And I matched them together, and they actually ended up having a conversation, the two of them, the author and the illustrator. And making that kind of match, you know, even if their experiences as are completely different, I still think that it's important to make that kind of match. Because ultimately, you know, I wouldn't, it's like hiring a female artist to do something on abortion. I don't really want to hire a male artist quite as much. Like for issues about a certain kind of experience, I want somebody who's experienced that.
Yeah. Yeah.
I wanted to, it's very complex.
Ronald. Ron. So it's something really interesting about, there are a lot of artists though, and this is one of the things I realized about comics, in particular, black cartoonists who they work in house styles, like, and they've been working hard. They basically built a foundation for artists like myself to maybe even capitalize on the commodity of my identity. They worked nearly invisible. Like sometimes I look back at the history of comics and like, yo, they were drawing whatever, you know, superhero stuff that, I mean, I didn't personally read, but like a lot of people read it, you know, and they were out there and like their identity wasn't, you know, forward on the page. And like, yo, in a weird way, it's empowering and it breaks my heart that like, I don't know, when I think about the content, I'm like, these people just like, they just did their job. Like they, you know, and their identity wasn't a part of the work. And I think there should be a space for that and a space for you to be like, well, this is a, you know, this is a particular area where I have some expertise or my experience will inform the work. I think it should, I think people who are not white men should have that option. And I think when we're talking about, I guess economically, like the what was it? We're talking about do I get, or like do, you know, capitalizing on my identity? Yeah. Well, of course I do.
Yeah.
But like so do white heterosexual men. Like we're all, you know, like when it comes down to it, like maybe that's the default. Like, you know, so on Black History Month comes, it's like, wow, okay, so this is the month where I get to be like, you know, that dude. You know what I mean? Like, I'm getting the jobs right now. Like, I'm the first person you think about.
Yeah.
You know, like, so I think it's maybe, whenever I get that sort of a question, I like to flip it and kind of think about, you know, well, describe what it's like in the privileged position, like apply that to a privileged person. Like that same question, if you're talking about like using your identity.
Yeah, I think we have another online question. We have so many questions.
I don't know if that's on this topic, but I had a question on this topic.
It's different. You can go first.
Okay. I just, you want to talk in the mic?
Yeah.
Get the mic.
Come on down.
There you go. All
right. As from the art director's point of view, you know, and I don't work in editorial, so I work in sci-fi. So, you know, there's sometimes specific issues of diversity come up or not, but I still find myself choosing people to relate to certain things in the story that maybe have a, you know, a background that relates to it or not. What I'm curious about is a lot of times I'll find as an art director, as I meet people or not, I'll be like, oh, I didn't know they were black, or oh, I didn't know they were Asian. And a name has a lot to do with that too. Some people, it's just obvious, or not. And you make assumptions about it. How do you guys each navigate that line in your work? Like some of you, you know, are talking about, you know, having the issues of your representation in your work, and some of you don't as much. How do you guys navigate? Do you feel like it's part of your responsibility to make it obvious that you are Asian or queer or woman or not in your work, or is it does that not have an impact?
Quick, isn't it obvious that like Bob Dylan is like a, you know, a straight Jewish guy? You know what I mean? Like, you know, like, so I think about it.
What he looks like.
But. Right. But I mean, even in works in general, authors. But I'm sorry.
No, you can talk about it.
Yeah. No, I mean, to springboard off of what I just had previously said, I think this is we're looking at it as something exceptional for people who are maybe marginalized, but like it's not that exceptional. Like a lot of artists, like primarily, even if their name is like you know, Joe Jackson, which would, you know, maybe, you know, because you don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, right, right. Right. But like then you see the art or, you know, whatever, and you're like, okay, well, their identity is forward. I think in most, you know, like pick a comic that's written and drawn by like some white men. It's like their identity is right there. Like it's boom, it's right there on the page. So I think like most artists, you do, if you're a person of color and you have to work in that sort of pastiche or like that sort of, then like you do the job. Mm-hmm. And I think even more so than someone who maybe is like a white man.
Yeah, totally. It took me a while to get to this place, but I don't view my Asianness as a liability. I think it's a position of strength, and I think that the art historical like traditions that inform my background can inform my work in new meaningful ways if I'm willing to contextualize them in a like uniquely American kind of setting. So that's a big thing for me, but also it took me a long time to get to that point. And that also doesn't mean that I can't not do something that doesn't require that background. I can inject 10% of myself in something, or if I'm lucky enough, I can put 95 to 100% of all my being like into these particular pieces. If I get that, that's great. But I'm also talented enough as a designer and drawer, hopefully, if it's not trash, I can solve all these other issues too. So I don't view it as a liability. I think it's important for my psyche to think of it as not a liability. Because I was at the point where I was viewing that as a liability. I grew up in the South, right? There's two Chinese Filipinos, it's me and my brother. Like, we're the only ones in like a city of 1 million people. And trying to reconcile that and like growing up in the Deep South, like it's really difficult. And I didn't get to that point where I could talk about this stuff, much less draw about it, until maybe like 2 or 3 years ago. So it takes a lot of work, but I think developing an awareness of myself alongside the technical skills allows me to operate from a position of strength. So I don't mind if people want that, and I don't mind if people want my drawing ability as well.
This is Cathy. Well, like, sometimes I think I'll make something and it'll be like so queer, and then no one sees it besides other queer people, you know? because I think it's like a question of privilege, because if you have privilege in certain ways, you don't have to consider these things when you're approaching it. And then I think in order to be, to kind of fight that and be anti-homophobic and anti-racist, is just kind of a question of just trying to educate yourself and like learn people's backgrounds and not make assumptions and stuff. I'm not saying it's you, I'm just in general.
it's like something like, because there's only so much you can do if someone doesn't like want to do it just because they want to, and not for any other like, oh, like I should because, but just like I want to.
I feel like being, sometimes you just have to be very deliberate to fight your privilege.
Yeah.
I want to say something.
Oh, yeah, sure.
This is Yao. I actually worry about it quite a lot, because I left school 2 years ago, so I'm still relatively new in doing freelance illustration work. And then I would say, like, when I don't meet people directly from my name, you can definitely tell I'm Chinese, but you can't tell I'm a woman. And you definitely, like, I won't even be like, hey, how are you? I'm queer. Like, you definitely not know I'm queer. So, like, when I hand people my business cards, when I email people, or when I send portfolios, or when I design my website, or even just like how I write my Twitter bio, I'm actually always worried, are people gonna assume that I am going to be specializing in Asian stuff? Like, I just happen to also be about worst in Chinese culture. My mom's a researcher, like I just like know that stuff, but like I worry like people would stash my card away and be like, oh wait until we have a foreign policy problem, or we'll wait until it's Chinese New Year's and we'll give this article about brain health to someone else. So I do worry about it, and then sometimes I have like come up with like fake names before. It's like when you're at Starbucks and you just don't want people to call your name, or like if you're in like an elevator full of men, like all of a sudden someone opens the door for you, it's like, oh my god, I'm a woman, like you just like woke up. And then like sometimes I feel like for people with a name, you know, if it's just like
not my name. Like when people meet you or when they see your card, it should be like a blank piece of paper, and then they can, I can tell them whatever I want to tell them, and I sometimes feel like I am losing that initial control over my marketing and my branding because people have preconceived assumptions about how this is. So anything that happens after that is going to be counter or like an affirmation. It's like, oh wait, yeah, okay, this is where like the Chinese stuff come in, or like, wait, they like didn't do anything Asian related, that's so weird. So like that's a pre thing that happens. Was like, I can't reverse that. I live with it. So that's my feeling.
Okay. Yeah. Actually, someone else want to say something?
Yeah.
One more thing. Okay. Yeah. Sure.
I think there's a huge spectrum of visibility. Like, you see the name Odera Igbokwe, and if you know like Nigerians, you're like, that's an Igbo Nigerian person. It says it in the name. You see my work, and it's representative, and it's like, well, they're drawing all black characters as default. And in my Black History Month series, looking for different artists, I was super surprised because I'd like have a list of 50 people and I'd have to cross off 10 because I'd be like, this isn't a black person. This is like a white guy doing children's books of black people. And it was like, it was, on one hand, it was like inspiring that they were doing this work because it had visibility. But on the other hand, it was like, are they benefiting and commodifying like black beauty if they're only drawing like black characters as their entire body of work?
And so like, where do they get those images from?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, mm-hmm. Like how personal are those?
Exactly. Yeah. exactly.
That's a good question. So this question is actually from Ron. Who's on the panel? And it's for Ron. No, it's not. So the question is, it's, you know, what about when you're hired to represent your perceived identity, but it's not your identity? I'll read the rest too. Okay, yeah. it's a good example. I don't know if you want me to read it. I.e., like, you know, quote unquote, like, hey, black guy, draw this rap comic, or like, I don't like rap though. I'm from Utah. I'm into Mongolian throat singing. Ron wrote that. That was good. That was good.
What about that though?
Yeah, but yes. What about that?
Hmm. Has that ever happened?
That hasn't happened to me, but I think if you're an illustrator who is underrepresented and it is a job that you want to take, you have that privilege to take that job because you don't have a lot of privilege.
Yeah.
I think it's important to get paid, but also I kind of purposely don't take jobs that are like, it's a queer book. Everyone's queer. Ha ha ha. Like, I don't. Like, I kind of purposely am not into that because I'm like, why are people picking this book up? Is it like, is it for artistic reasons? It's just not something.
You don't feel like it's like being like consumed, like, oh, cool. Like, now it's.
Yeah. I don't want to be like the queer cartoonist, you know?
Yeah.
I want to be Cathy.
Oh, well, yeah, I'll say she
I
wants
to. I think if like someone's like, hey, she's a queer cartoonist, she's not an Asian cartoonist, like that's a weird, like, nice way of saying it. And then like you are always like on this roll of like all of your labels, like which one's gonna land on like face first, like am I gonna be yeah, so there's that too. Like, I would be in a queer book because they would need like queer people who are color in it, and then I'm like, I would want to be in that book.
So it depends on like how many, pretty much like your personal intersections too. It's like, oh, mm-hmm. For some person it's like, oh, I don't want to do that. Other person's like, oh, this is like a relief that I get to like now jump to like this one.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I want to just say something real quick.
I mean, those books are cool.
I did do the rap comic. Like, my editor actually is out there in the audience. And like, I do like rap. I just wanted, that was just for the, you know, playing devil's advocate.
It's a hypothetical. We have so many questions. We have a online question. Audience? Okay.
She had a
Which one? Yeah. Okay. Whoever had it first, just come on up.
Get her.
To the microphone. Any microphone.
You need one of the mics from Price is Right. Oh, you can get it all there.
Oh, man. Cool dress.
Okay.
I guess, like, first, I actually do have an answer to that question. I once was, like, tapped to do, like, they, it was a, I don't want to name names because it happened very recently, where I was tapped to do something specifically because, like, this publisher was looking for women of color illustrators. Mm-hmm. And when I got the script, it was very, very specific to an identity that was not mine, to the point that I felt like very uncomfortable. And I was like, well, now you're just picking me to like say, like, you know, we have a woman of color on here, which is like, it sucked because it was like, on one hand, I was like, I'm glad you went out of your way to do that. But on the other hand, I wish you like looked at like my work and looked at the content and like paired it like, and thought about it that way.
Trying.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And then it, I had to have like a very uncomfortable like email conversation that didn't end well, but well, it ended as well as I could make it end, but it wasn't amazing. Anyway, I wanted to ask about like, for example, like when you're like writing your stories, I feel like there's sort of sometimes a burden or like a baggage of like wanting to make your protagonist like the same, like your identity, but then being kind of afraid to have like that, like since, for example, like as an Asian woman, there's not, as an Asian American woman, there's not many like Asian American protagonists. So then there becomes like a burden to make your representation like the perfect representation, and it, and so it gets kind of daunting to the point that like, okay, maybe I'll just like make a white character, like make her like half white or something like that to like sort of compromise that. Is there like anything you guys do to get over it? Or,
well, I think it's everybody's prerogative, right? I was kind of talking about, you know, your only responsibility is to be honest. If you're writing a story, everyone tells you to write from your own experience. So what that means to you might be different than what it means to other people. So, you know, there was a book published recently about a from a Chinese American writer that was living in Brooklyn about the Deep South, and he had never set foot in the Deep South. And it was a great book. Like, it was a very actually nuanced, like detailed representation of the South, and he had never actually visited there. But then all the critics were jumping on him, like, "Oh, you're a Chinese American. You don't know what that's like. You don't know what the Deep South is like," because obviously there's no Chinese in the South, which is wrong. But but it's also like they just didn't believe that he had the craft to tell this particular story, which again kind of goes into like, well, you have to tell this story because you are Chinese. So when somebody's like telling you what to do, then that becomes a little bit problematic, right? It's like, you expect me to create this certain type of work. And on that grounds, I would be like, no, like, I can do whatever. But it's also, we have to open up the doors in terms of, like, a white male artist, can he draw something? Like, can he draw a person of color? Can he draw a perspective? It's like, absolutely. Every editorial job that gets put out, like, probably 99 other artists could do that. But the fact that you got chosen means that you have to bring to the table your own experiences, and that, you know, that's up to you. It should be up to you.
Yeah, I feel like, I mean, when you were, if you were offered a job, I would just say take it. And
just don't even
like,
ask.
Because they're, yeah, like, and then you can do your own spin on it, like exactly how you think it is. If someone comes back and be like, this is generic, which is like a thing that does happen a lot, people are like, this is generic, and I'm always like, you know, this is what actually happens to my life. If you think it's generic, this is how I live. Like, I can like I have this, like, it's like a chronic thing that happens when you're an Asian woman and everyone knows what you're talking about. And I was like, that is something that is wrong, the way that people who look like me are treated. And then now everything I write, it's like everyone else is writing, because everyone is treating someone in a very generic, non-creative way. And then like, my work is hurt by that. So that's like, I was like, if you want me to put like a creative spin on it, I don't have any, because that's like how, that's how it is. Or sometimes you have like something that's really quirky and people are like, wait, that's like, does that really happen? You're like, yeah.
Like, it's so I would say, like, if it is your personal experience and you feel like it doesn't represent, like, you're not supposed to do it, and then it's partially your reader and your audience's responsibility to take everything with critical thinking.
I also think you have to, this is Odera, you all have to recognize not every piece will be your magnum opus. Mm-hmm. You will draw many Asian characters. If you do one and it's not great, then you'll draw more. If it doesn't represent every aspect of who you are, much less the entire population of Asian women, then that's okay, because you will continue to keep drawing, I hope.
Yeah. Who's the next question?
So we only have time for
Oh no! Can we extend it 3:30?
I got three questions online. If you want to maybe like shotgun
them all. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Come on up. Come on up.
Come on down.
I really appreciate everyone coming up. I'm very thankful for this conversation. I don't know how many of you ride the subway, but we always see the same stories on the ads in the subway. At least that's my perception. I'm curious, what stories are you tired of seeing? And what stories would you like to see more of?
That's a good ass question.
Yeah.
So.
Stories on the subway.
Or like in the ads or like in the, where?
Yeah, the ads that are just like,
oh, okay.
A lot of money behind
yeah.
them and
yeah.
just
yeah.
plastered everywhere.
Yeah, I'm a little tired of the like, if you don't have a lot of money, you should go to art school once. It's like kind of, it's like kind of not cool. Yeah.
Yeah, for a little bit. Yeah.
I can
come on down.
All right, so a story I'm tired of. Does this work? Okay, hey. A story I'm personally, as an illustrator, tired of seeing is the struggle narrative. Like when a black illustrator gets hired to do a piece, it's usually about strife, affliction, and overcoming. You know, and pretty much not showing any positive outcomes of being a black person in America.
I was going to speak on, and this has just been recent, it's been over a year with all the police brutalities. I think I'm tired of seeing this picture of like this aggressive black person. I'm going to speak from a job I got approached on, which I turned down, and I want people to know if you're not feeling comfortable with a job or it's not speaking to you, you can turn it down. Mm-hmm. I got approached to do a job that involved police brutality, killings of black women, and rape, and I straight up was not comfortable with that. And even though I could like identify with like what's going on in my community, I just... fatigue, and just based on how tired I was of that story, I didn't want to illustrate for that story anymore, because we have this reactionary pull that a lot of, I guess, storytellers and a lot of media and writers and directors are trying to get from us. I feel like they're trying to get this certain emotion pulled from us with a lot of these stories that I'm not sure, and I can't speak for everyone in my community. I'm not sure they want to speak for. I am kind of tired of like talking about that issue. I'm tired of like protesting about that issue. I'm tired of kind of like yelling into the void that I'm tired of this happening. And I guess I'm kind of tired of those struggle stories where it's always like from like, we're struggling to do this and struggling from like enslavement and this and that. And I'm not seeing enough stories where we exist on a spectrum. It's always we're either one way or we're another way. And we're not getting the queer folks who are like doctors or the queer folks who are this way or Asian Americans who are this way or just marginalized people who exist in different categories. It's always one way or the other. And I know I'm tired of those stories where it's always the extremes. It's either this black person who is, and I hate this term, a thug, or it's the black person who's the token nerdy kid. and we aren't allowed to exist on another spectrum besides those two. And I don't know if that's happening in other communities where, like, you guys only exist in a certain way. But yeah, those are the stories I'm tired of seeing a lot. I know they need to get talked about, but it is tiresome to just speak on those all the time and illustrate for those all the time.
I think those are so tiring because they're so painful. It's like every week, it's like there is a new black body at the hands of police brutality. Would you like to comment? And it's like, you know what I said earlier
about
are.
the spectacle.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Like consumption.
Sometimes they're more concerned with the spectacle than actual change. I remember I was on Humans of New York, and the guy, he saw me, and he was just like, ooh, this is great. I'm going to go up to this guy and ask questions. He's like, so what's the hardest thing you've ever endured in your life? And I was like, I'm just trying to pick up this dog poop. I'm sorry. And he was like, so are you queer? Are you? And I'm like, I just like video games and Chun-Li and all these different things. And exactly. So I think I'm most tired of seeing that contemporary slave narrative, whether it's in the Oscars. It's like you think of the movies that have black nominations, and it's like, well, you're either a prostitute or a slave, or it's like, what happened after the year 1900? Yeah. Nothing.
Yeah, nothing happened. We didn't do anything after that.
Do we have another question?
We could start firing off the internet.
Okay. How many internet questions do we have queued up? 1,000? Okay, that's not that bad.
I'm not going to tell you to keep your intro short, but keep your intro short? No.
Okay.
All right, let's start.
We'll see what happens.
May I please?
Yes, you may.
Thank you.
Okay, I think... I wanted to add, we've been talking a lot about teachers and content and all this thing, but I see teachers as art directors. That's how I treat my class, as if I was an art director. So having an art director on the panel, I'm curious to kind of open that up. And to this question from the internet, how do you guys balance talking about social issues on your social media or in your life, I guess, publicly in an effective way without tarnishing your reputation amongst art directors and potential clients? There you go.
For me, I think if the way I speak about any issue that is affecting me or oppressing me, if that tarnishes my relationship, that potential person is not someone I want to work with. So it does the work for me.
Yeah, I think I totally agree. It's just like, if you are already like beating out people that you wish you'd never known in the future, like that's kind of a favor that you do to yourself. Because if you were not speaking about it, they didn't know that about you, they hire you for a job and you disagree and you're like, why am I at this place in my life working with this person? You're beating that out of your life. And there are plenty of people who want to hire you, so.
Yeah, I'll read them.
All right, you just think these two right there.
Okay. I now have the internet in my hands. Let's see. Okay, wow, that's pretty good. Two at the top?
The gray ones.
The gray ones. Okay, so how do you guys feel about the direct market sale of comics and how it impacts new talent and new voices from getting established and, like, you know, maybe moving up the rungs? You know, since it's all kind of like pre-sale driven, it's like established names, and publishers are kind of the only ones that benefit from it. So what can be done to change this?
I don't know what direct market sales are.
Yeah. It's like you're selling to stores and stuff.
Yeah, like,
publishers selling to the distributor to stores. I don't know, like, I think it's tiresome, Ronald. I think it's tiresome.
Tiresome.
It's a weird place for me to speak from, because like I've gotten to a position now where I kind of like, I don't know, that's my bread and butter, I guess, you know. But for the people who are kind of moving in different circles, I think what's exciting, I mean, I just think the internet is exciting. Like, I don't really even read a lot of like comics. Like, I don't go to the comics. I get like Hellboy, that's it. You know what I mean? Like, I think the internet is just, I mean, how do you monetize? I don't know. I think if I were speaking to someone who's young and trying to come up and like they're concerned with this topic, I would be like, you know, be on the internet, think about alternative ways of monetizing, like, I don't know, maybe look into Patreon, maybe look into, you even take it to like coming out of the back of your trunk with something, except with the internet, you know, like you just, you're talking to people, individuals who, like I see, I forget what they call it, but there's something where someone can, they can give you a little bit of bread for your comic, and it's like, I just saw it online the other day, I forget what it's called though. Gumroad, you know what I mean? Like, I think that's an avenue, and some of the people online are getting more views. I don't know if they're making more money or like if they're, but at the same time, are the artists getting that money anyway? Even in, you know, comics, you might get a better rate than someone working for Boom. I imagine you would. So that would be my advice.
Yeah, I would say I started self-publishing my comics, and I don't put them out for free ever. Like, even if someone, like, I draw for Autostraddle, it pays $40 a strip, but it is not free. And then people do use the site, and the site gets paid by sponsoring ads. And, you know, like, there's like, you are not part of giving something out for free. And I think it's great that way. Like, everyone should feel like they are reading your comics, not like a piece of free flyer somewhere on the street. And then, like, sometimes people work that way. Like, you make them give you a little money, and all of a sudden they respect you more. And I would say, like, you can start really small, and then sometimes, like, life just gets really hard, and you need to figure out how to feed yourself. Like, that's just a thing that everyone does. And I would just say, like, it might not happen overnight, and it might not happen in 2 years, might not happen in 10 years, but it maybe will happen later, and you have to have that patience.
Yeah. Okay, so we have this another question from the internet. This one's for Yao and John. It's on the Asian American diaspora experience. There's a little hyphen there too. So. Yeah. There's a little more to the question. And saying, this is speaking from a Chinese American who grew up mostly in the U.S. Do you guys ever feel kind of pulled between kind of having two different backgrounds, and almost as if you're unqualified to accurately, you know, portray either cultural experience, Chinese versus American, in your work?
I'll try to relate this to a larger context, because I don't think it's like, you don't want to hear me just rant about Asian Americans for 2 hours, although I could. But yeah. I think the one thing you got to realize is that Asian American doesn't mean anything. That's a political term that was invented in the 60s as a radical reinvention of ethnic coalitions between different ethnic groups. So its radical invention in the 60s means we have to create it. So you aren't representing Chinese. You're not Chinese. You're Chinese American. You're Asian American. You have a context that is very specific to yourself. You probably feel the need to be Chinese, but, like, for the most part, you don't have that experience. And so you shouldn't speak to that experience. Again, be honest, right? You have to create your own. So it's the most, like, liberating thing that I could think of is, like, I don't have to do that. I shouldn't do that. I should write about, I should draw, I drew Darth Vader just not too long ago, contextualized with a Filipino death, like pre-colonial death mask, because they looked exactly similar. And there was connections there. There was connective tissue between these two things. But I wouldn't have arrived to that point until I realized that I had to take the onus on myself to create this history. So yes, you don't have to speak to that, and you shouldn't, but you should work on yourself and make it for yourself.
Okay, I'm gonna try to answer it, but it's like, ultimately it is your experience as a person, and there's not really like the thing is, there's not really like a American experience that you can represent, and there's not really a Chinese experience you can like, if someone comes up to you and says that they can do that, they're lying. It's not real. Like, it's like, people would come up to you and want you to represent it. You have to tell them whatever you're imagining, it doesn't exist. Like, my life, it's my life. And I don't even know, like, I would say that I
raised myself here for like 10 years. I'm not going back to China. I don't have citizenship. Like, you tell me what my experience is. And sometimes, like, you have a community, which is great. Sometimes you don't have a community. And I would say if you do have a community, you also don't have to feel like your community's experience is yours. And then not everyone in that community, like, you have some shared similarities and you have some stuff you can talk about. It's really great when you meet people who are like, oh my God, I feel that way too. But there's going to be some part of you that's just you. Like, maybe you like to read, you like to drive. Like, it's like, and then, you know, and then you want to, if you just like want to make those comics about like random people you date, like, you should be able to just do that. And if someone like comes up to you and be like, wait, but like, does that represent the Chinese American experience? You're like, I don't know what you're talking about. Like,
one other quick note too, when I was talking about the radical invention of Asian Americans, they got that from the Yellow Power movement, which is based off the Black Power movement. So you talk about coalitions, you talk about being alone, you're part of the fabric of America, and your natural allies are other minorities. Literally, your definition of Asian American comes from the Black Power movement. So there is natural, you know, things that you have in common with other minorities. So look outside of your own communities and see what you have in common with each other.
Or within your broader community.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah. This is Odera. I'm not Asian American, but I can say as someone of a diaspora that no one can take away any piece of your identity from yourself. You get to choose what you reclaim and take.
Do we have one more question? Time for one more question? We're done? Wrap it up? Yeah? One more? Hey, I'm moderating. Fuck it. Wait. Hey, one more? Anybody?
No, someone had it.
Somebody had it? Yes. Come on down. Yeah, come on.
I'll just talk loud.
Okay.
Creative director in children's publishing for 28 years. So.
Actually, wait. Come down because people on the internet might not be able to hear you. Yeah. Yeah. It's for all of them.
Creative director in children's publishing. Actually, you are all privileged in being in a field that I do think in general is culture blind. Race blind. If I saw any of your names besides an Asian name, I wouldn't know who you are. I only look at the artwork. And it sounds like all of you can market yourselves how you want to be. If you want to be a queer illustrator, you are one. If you want to be Asian. But it seems like we should also, I see a piece of yours on the wall. It's not about African American culture or anything, and that's what you get to do. So isn't it also great that you are here and you can market yourselves how you want to? You know, we do in publishing, we do try to find black illustrators to go with black stories, not because we want to avoid bad reviews, it's because we want it to be an authentic story.
Yeah.
But we also could hire anybody based on their art only. That's your
yeah. Yeah, well, the
celebration of that in all of you, you all get to be who you want depending on how you market yourself.
Yeah, I think, it's actually interesting because the Tear Tracks piece was actually, the story wasn't specific about her ethnicity, so I actually made her dark, assuming, like, I was just going to make her, like, in my mind, like, a black woman without making her a black woman. So, in a way, it kind of is. It's kind of like what, I forget who said it earlier about, like, just the fact that I make it, it already is. I think it's kind of weird to connect it to like marketing, but it's almost kind of revealing at the same time because it's like, oh, if you market it, but it's like, who's in the market, who's expecting that? So it's like, I don't know. It's kind of weird. It's kind of weird to connect it in that type of way, I think.
I think also too, there's a danger that we have to think about. There are no numbers on illustration in terms of who's working in the field. And there's no numbers in terms of race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, but if you look at every other field, every other creative field, it is majority white, disproportionate to the actual population of the United States. So if you look at New York City, 75% of the people working in art in New York City who have art degrees and are making all their money off of art, they are white. New York City is 33% white, right? New York City is 13 to 15% Asian American, and maybe 20% of the 20% of the people that have art degrees are Asian American. Only 8% make their money. The numbers are the same. It's like the numbers are the same. Every minority, they're held into these single digits. So you're talking about the people that are hiring, the people that are making the work. does that really reflect the racial reality? Same thing for Hollywood. Same thing for publishing. So I'm looking at all of these things, and I see a pattern there. I don't have the numbers. I can't tell you exactly what it is in illustration, but everything else in every other creative industry points to a reality that isn't reflective of what we're talking about. So,
yeah, this is Yao. I would say like it's we can market ourselves however we want, but I would say it's very difficult and it's not flexible. Like you kind of get one or two shots, and like I think it's very difficult to get people to understand that I do want to do all the Asian stories and then some like other stories, and then you kind of are blocked off one way or another. I think for books it might be a little better, but definitely for editorial, you either like market yourself as like I can do all the Asian stuff, and then you kind of have to like really avoid doing it for people to like want to put you there, because you're kind of running like on the tabs of things that you like people think you can do, and then they kind of just like don't think of you for other things.
Also, just one, I guess, final note on that point. Diversity, when we talk about diversity, we talk about inclusion, and we talk about having all of these voices. Illustration is it's a creative industry. We can only be strengthened by having a lot of different voices. Think of all the art historical traditions you just completely ignore because you don't learn about them in art school. You don't see them reflected in the current trends of illustration. If we had all these different voices contributing to a larger whole, all of our work would be better. Mm. All of our work would be better. There would be so many more avenues. So we have to think of diversity, quote unquote, as a strength of the industry.
Ron, didn't you say earlier? You said something like, inclusivity by its very nature is meritocracy.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
We want a normalcy of diversity. We want to become normal.
It's a funny thing because
Ronald.
Wrap it up. This is just to piggyback on what you just said. I found that if you do include aesthetic traditions that aren't, say, you know, Western, like all of a sudden that gets othered and tokenized within your work, you know? Like, so if you wanted to, okay, like I'm influenced by like, you know, Indian, like the silk screen paintings, you know, whatever. Like, okay, well, you're an Indian. I like how you mix up like Indian and hip hop culture or whatever. You know what I mean? It's like, what are you talking about, B? Like, it's an aesthetic tradition. It's like, I'm American, first of all. Like, and it's all here. Like, I'm in New York. So, absolutely. I agree with you 1,000%.
Yeah. Well,
two mics.
I'll take two mics.
So, only had 2 hours, and it's like, it's still never enough time. And this will not be like, we'll keep doing this as like part 3,000. Just keep going. Thank everybody for coming out. Stories Matters, too. Thanks for asking questions. Keep talking, which I think is the most important thing. Like, once it's done, just keep going. Talk after the show. Ask us questions after the show. Thank you. Thanks for coming out. Yeah. Also thank the panelists too. Yeah. And also the host, John Jensen.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Oh. And Society of Illustrators. Okay. I think that's it. I think that's it. Yeah.